angels waging war in the unseen realm. Global events fulfilling biblical prophecy. Eternal life. What lies beyond mortality? From analyzing the paranormal from a biblical worldview to the discussion of cutting-edge science and technology, conspiracy, discovery, special investigative reports. Unafraid to explore the challenging issues facing humanity, welcome to another edition of Skywatch TV.
Hi folks, this is Tom Horn again, coming to you from the studios here in Missouri at Skywatch TV. And once again, so privileged to be able to have my good friend Steve Quayle in the studio with me. Hi Steve.
Hey Tom, it's really great to be back and to take the next series of amazing events and amazing fulfillments of prophecy and our mutual investigations and research expeditions going on concurrently, unknown to either one of us. The only time we find out what each other is doing is we do radio interviews together. So now we're beating that. We're doing a jump step. We're doing it on TV.
Yeah, but it makes me wonder what next is going to happen between the two of us. Maybe we'll talk about that in a moment with Timothy Alberino's project. We're going to be talking mostly today about this book that you put out recently called True Legends. And I love that title, by the way, because, you know, we have these legends throughout the United States of America, throughout the world. Everybody seems to have their mythos. And yet there's such commonalities in the stories that were told that seem to attest to a time when there really were things that were going on in the world that involved giants and things like that. So we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But first, speaking of giants, I learned recently that Timothy Alberino, who is your partner in crime, your partner in filmmaking, he's been producing a whole lot of just world-class, like mini documentaries that you guys are putting up.
That's a good word.
What's the name of your film company?
Gen 6, short for Genesis 6 Productions. Yeah. And thanks for bringing it up because Tim just got back. Today's, what, the 21st, 22nd of what month is this, April?
All right.
Yeah, you know, I keep strange hours, but Tim just got back from a three-week trip to Peru, and we had a fascinating series of events that happened, and obviously Skywatch will be airing it. But what we're up to pretty much, Tom, is we're tracking down the giant cover-up that's taking place on multiple continents, multiple cultures, and I think I can explain to people the number one question that the doubters and the skeptics have, well, where are all the skeletons? Well, Tim just returned from Peru, and fascinating, he was at Tiwanaku, he was in Bolivia, and he said in Bolivia, they're undertaking a new dig, and the Bolivians just announced a whole new pyramid find, and what's fascinating is no matter where Tim has been in the last 3 months, Sardinia, obviously in Europe, Peru, Bolivia, and a couple points in between, the fascinating thing is, number one, they're always followed. Number two, everybody they interview, that's, let's say, over 75 years to 80 years, has a common, if you will, statement of who comes in to grab all the artifacts, especially when it's giant-related. They're talking about helicopters landing at night. They're talking about big helicopters lifting very heavy items. And in Peru, for instance, one of the amazing things at a place called Sacsayama, I'm probably not pronouncing it right, but the fascinating thing is that they ran into an engineer who is a secular engineer that said the ancients had to have had a way to liquefy the stone because the stone in some instances flows in and pours in together, just like you and I, you know, playing with Play-Doh, fitting piece A to piece B. Now, this is a secular engineer, but fascinatingly enough, that every place that Tim went, they were followed most of the time. It didn't matter if it was in Sardinia. The hush-hush, there were people that were actually afraid to go on camera. We had many times we could only record their voice because they were afraid of them. And interesting, them was the Vatican. Well, obviously, if anybody knows the history, and you well know, but of South America, Latin America, and even different parts of Europe, there's an absolute stranglehold on true artifacts and true history. But what was mind-blowing to both of us, and even the people that accompanied, whether they were translators, a film crew, is just how touchy anybody was for filming. It was okay if you filmed on the right hand, but don't go over on the left hand. The right hand was like I would call staged artifact. Some of the most famous artifacts you see on the Ancient Alien series and all the different, they've been moved from a place where they really made sense to a place where they don't make sense. Tim said an interesting thing. Tim said it was like, Steve, you could see the pre-flood building and you could see the post-flood building. They'll let you see all the post-flood building you want, but they won't let you see the pre-flood stuff. In Bolivia, they were met by armed guards carrying machine guns. So that's what we're up against. Now, this is important, Tom, for your research too. There are people working overtime to keep the truth of what is really out there and true history. I said in an earlier interview, they who control the past determine the future. If you and I are only told 3 points on a 12-point instruction to follow, we don't do good after maybe 4 or 5. Mm-hmm. We're going to mess it up. So by keeping people in this state of, I would call, I've got to be really careful here, I call mainstream media vomit brokers, okay? So by them only giving...
And that's being careful.
That's being careful. That's the best I can do. You know, either that or I have a mouthful of soap. The point being is that it's... They want to regurgitate some facts, but most fiction, into the narrative, whether it's anything that you and I talk about collectively. Yet when you go to the desert southwest, you and Chris go down there, Chris Putnam, or Tim's going here, or I'm going to a Native American reservation, you'll find out that there's a whole different world out there that these people who lived and their ancestors chronicled it, and people absolutely see the Norway spiral, but they can't accept the fact that, gee, how did the Native Americans, or how did, 4,000-year-old civilizations, why do they all use the universal symbol?
Uh-huh, right. And now, this is also part of a documentary, or a series of documentaries. So tell me about that. What you're doing, of course, is kind of producing documentation and in documentary format of a lot of stuff that you already have been investigating for some time on the presence of giants, but also even like you talk about Amaruca, if I'm saying it right, like the whole origin of how America got its name. And the Freemasons even write about this, don't they? Talking
yes,
about
they do.
Where the knowledge of the mystical schools came from here, as it, what, came from the plume serpents?
The plume serpent, Quetzalcoatl, Viracocha, both in the Aztec and Mayan history. The plume serpent, Amaruca, or A-M-E-R-U-C-A. That's what the South American and the high cultures called America, and that's land of the plume serpent. Now, when you see pictures of Quetzalcoatl, you know the classic representation is a feathered serpent.
Mm-hmm.
Almost looks like basically the reptilians in the old science fiction movie V with a whole bunch of feathers. I know that's simplistic, but that's what it is. So by finding out where all of these customs that came in the United States. There was a time, for instance, where people, even the major anthropology magazines, never wanted to admit that the Native Americans necessarily in the desert southwest were cannibals.
Mm-hmm.
I remember fighting that argument 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So the point being now is, or the Anasazi, the ancient ones, which you and Chris, you know, have talked, or the alien ones, what is the central theme in all these, by the way, is cannibalism.
Mm-hmm.
Now what we're seeing in the headlines is cannibalism. You're seeing it in all shapes and forms, whether it's the Christian, our brethren in Syria, being slaughtered and basically cannibalized, their meat sold for meat in the market, and the world, especially the Western church, is silent.
Mm-hmm.
That makes me just go, I said this, the customs of the ancient ones will come into the contemporary times, and you'll know we're in the end times. And that's exactly, now, people didn't, there was very little cannibalism 20 years ago. Maybe the case of the airliner that went down in the Andes, you know, and situation survival. But there was never, you know, basically cookbooks on the internet yet, and people advertising for people to come and basically let someone kill them, as in the case of Germany, and eat them.
It's interesting because, you know, you mentioned me and Chris had been doing, again, investigative work, not even knowing you were working on this brand new book, True Legends, where you're taking the stories that had been told by many of the American Indian tribes and the legends of the stories. I want to ask you in a few moments about the Smithsonian. Don't let me forget to ask you about that. But while you were doing that, we were actually going to the Four Corners area. Chris went down to the, to the southern end of the Anasazi Trail, as I started calling it, in Sedona. And what does he find there in Sedona but the presence of the Vatican, you know, had built and in an area where nobody else is allowed to build, they get to build this kind of Catholic thing. It's the church. It's a monastery sticking out of the side of the mountain. We found the same thing on the top of Mount Graham. Everywhere there seems to be these portals and these entities, it's like there's a very strong presence there, as if they know something we don't know, or they're pursuing something ahead of us. But the point I was going to make is I got a chance to sit down with Dr. Don Mosey. And he's a third-generation medicine man. He is he's an academic, or he's a retired academic in the Navajo Nation. I should have brought his book and showed it to you, where he had an artist depict giants that used to be in the United States. Some of them, it looked like they're 200 feet tall. It took whole tribes to bring them down. Mm-hmm. And when they finally got them down and cut their head off, there was so much blood that came out, it flowed down into the valley like it was forming a small river. This is in the books that he had written. Well, here's the interesting thing. I'm interviewing him, and I ask him, so tell us, what happened to the Anasazi? And he starts, you know, telling the tale that they hear in school. Well, there was a drought, and then 7 years of a drought, they follow, you know, they start migrating slowly away. But I raised questions about that. I said, and yet when the archaeologists first went into those cliff dwellings, they found that they had disappeared overnight. They didn't slowly migrate away. They left everything, bags of salt that would have been like gold, right? So where did they go? Well, he looks at the camera. We have this on film. And he says, well, I shouldn't tell you this, but if you were to ask my great-grandfather, this is a story that he would have told. And Steve, it was like he had opened up True Legends and started reading, because he talks of a portal, the serpent deceiver that comes through the portal, the six-toed giants. But he also says that this deceiver started teaching the people cannibalism. That was my whole point. Mm-hmm. They started eating one another. The giants were eating them. We did follow-up research that isn't even in our book, where we found old university archaeological digs, where they found Anasazi that had literally been ripped apart. They found their bones, the sinew, the flesh had been literally ripped apart and left on the ground.
The rib cages split.
Yeah.
Well, it's funny you would say that, Tom, because, again, this illustrates it. In the book Long Walkers, a pilot who was an active-duty Air Force pilot flew into Bagram Air Force Base, I believe, in the year 2005. And I know him personally, came to my store, bona fides, verified, etc., and told the story. Now, you just talked about being ripped apart. Well, he was tasked with flying a dead giant who had cannibalized a squad of Marines that were going in looking for Bin Laden's boys, you know, Al-Qaeda in the caves and everything. And interestingly enough, the very description that was given to the team that basically produced the giant cadaver for him, it takes a special way of killing giants. He said it was like their rib cages were ripped apart. Hmm. Isn't that interesting? So you're in the desert Southwest talking to that very intelligent man, and his grandfather, I would tell you this, would know more about the truth than all the twisting.
Well, Dr. Mose is a third-generation Navajo Nation medicine man and oral historian whose
right.
books are used in their
schools.
So, yeah, he's no Johnny come lately.
I think the big discrepancy between fact and fantasy is that as the older generation dies off, this is why Tim, I mean, he's sitting on a reed island in Lake Titicaca, okay, and he's interviewing a I think is like a 75 or 80-year-old man who only speaks the language that has to be translated into Spanish. Now, Tim speaks perfect Spanish and lived in Peru, so that helps. Mm-hmm. But it's always the same story. So they're talking about the helicopters coming in, talking about cannibalistic giants, and how's this for an interesting story? They go to a place called Amaramuru, which is a Stargate location, an actual Stargate. So they have shamans there, and they're ringing a bell, and they're taking a like a metal object, and like you would take your thumb and make a crystal glass hum. They're basically making all these different noises. Now, I've been told by the people that know a lot about this stuff that Stargates work on words, sounds, and a power source. I never found out what the power source was. But while Tim, Vinny, and Benny, those are the three guys in the crew, are camped out at the Stargate, it rains, it hails. They've got this on video. And he said it was the most strangest thing they've ever seen, because around them, everything was clear. But right where they were was, if you will, this directed hailstorm. He said it was so furious that they had to go and get half the village to come and pull their car out and dig their car out of the mud, because basically they had gone up there to see this event. But the strangest lightning, the strangest sound. So what am I saying here? I'm saying that in your findings and our corollary investigation research, the common denominators are always the same. I think I've told you this before, mentioned it on the radio. I was contacted by a major film studio years ago, five years ago, and they wanted to know if I would be willing to make the Giants rewrite a movie script that I had written. And, basically making the Giants nice people. And I said, fee-fi-fo-fum, I smell the blood of an Englishman. Doesn't sound to me like they're eating burgers, okay? Right. So the point being is that even Shrek, there was a cartoon, and they made Shrek. An ogre is a human-eating monster, O-G-R-E. Yeah, not Congress, because there's some of those guys too. Those just eat the fruit of the land. But the point being is that we're seeing now in the corollary investigations that we're doing, the common denominators. And the Anasazi, it's fascinating. You jump to Easter Island now, and Easter Island used to have a curse, and the curse was, your grandmother's flesh lies rotting in my teeth. Lovely, huh? That was a National Geographic. So there's been a cover-up, because again, what's troubling to me is that I see the parasitical appetites of demons coming into common acceptance. I don't play video games. I can honestly say I don't think I've ever played one more than 2 minutes, and then my attention span was over, and my manual dexterity is not what it used to be. I was teasing you about Joe. I love the way he plays the guitar. Yeah. My thumbs and fingers don't move that fast anymore. But the thing that's fascinating to me is that the theme in these video games is getting darker and darker. Do you know what the number one selling comic book and cartoon series is in Japan? It's about man-eating giants, okay? And these are like 200-foot tall giants. So when you asked me earlier what's the difference about this Genesis 6 revised volume versus the first one I wrote, is the Woods document, they're 200, 300, 400-foot giants, especially Polyphemus. That goes right back to the Cyclops. That goes right back to Jason the Argonaut. It goes right back. And the Greeks, for instance, one of the, two ancient wonders of the world was, the Colossus of Rhodes. That was just, that was 99 feet, and it spanned the harbor. Then you have the Temple of Zeus, which is kind of a portrayal on Genesis 6 giants. And that was a real temple where real giants sat. And held court. And these guys were in their 40 and 50 and 60 foot tall. So, well, Paul Bunyan and all those stories may have been dismissed. When you found out from your Native American contact, and I'm hearing the same thing from my contacts around the world, because when you and I go on talk radio, it goes all over the world, and millions of people listen, and we'll hear from Australia, we'll hear from Siberia, we'll hear from all over the place. I mean, I've heard people say, we listen to you on satellite radio. And I said, you mean like Sirius? He said, oh, no, we're on satellite. We're getting you from the satellite downlink. So they must be in some research facility or have some capability. But those are the kind of people that make contact with us to give us the leads. We follow up. And so I think it's time. I refer to this over and over. It's time for those hidden things to be revealed. And again, the people of God have nothing to fear. Now, if they know what's coming and we're articulating it, defining it, and preparing them for it, then they will deal with it in victory versus in subterfuge, defeat, and total panic.
We've been talking here with my good friend Steve Quayle. You can see why I love talking to Steve, right? How do you do this with no notes? I mean, do you have a mind like a steel trap? Right now, we've been talking about the book True Legends, and this is one of your newest books. This just only came out just a few months ago.
No, that one came out about a year ago. Little Creatures
about six months ago. Actually, this is even newer than that, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's new. That's like 2 weeks old.
Little Creatures, and then Genesis 6 Giants. This is actually what is this, a third edition, or it's your new edition?
It's an expanded? It's a new edition, but if it were going by the old line, it would be the 10th printing of it.
Okay. But we're making all three of Steve Quayle's books available to you at a very special price. We're also throwing in we typically retail this for $30, volume one of the Researcher's Library of Ancient Texts. This is the Apocrypha, but it has many of the books that you'll find sourced in Steve's books, like the Book of Enoch and some of the other ancient works like Jubilees, which also talks about the giants, also talks about the return of the giants and the fallen angels. Normally, these books all sell for $40 each because they're 2 to 3 times as big as anybody else's works. That would normally, between those three books and the Apocrypha, that would be $150 value, but we are making that available to you during these programs only for a special price of $99. If you call in the number that's on the screen, or if you visit skywatchtv.com, you will be able to get these books from our online store. If you call in, just tell them that you're looking for the Steve Quayle package, the Steve Quayle special, and you'll get all of those books for the special price of $99. Of course, we have each one of these available in the store for sale by themselves. If you want to buy just Genesis 6 Giants or the new Little Creatures book, I'm sure that we'd be happy to make those available to them, too. Well, Steve, we've got about 5 minutes left here, and there's a question I just keep wanting to get to.
Let's go for it.
And it's the question of the Smithsonian. In your book, right towards the very beginning of True Legends, you tell a story that some people are familiar with, probably most people are not familiar with. Some people just call this the Great Smithsonian Cover-Up. Tell me about that.
Well, first of all, the Smithsonian was basically founded by a man named Smithson, obviously where you get the name Smithsonian, and he hired a gentleman named Powell, for instance, who was a pretty well-known expedition leader. Lake Powell is named after him, but he became the curator. He suffered from a thing called isolationism. He wouldn't allow the thought that there were other civilizations and or people that had the ability to, number one, travel by ship. He thought that everybody grew up in an isolated area. And, you know, some people call that isolationism. Some people call it uniformitarianism. But that's as opposed to diffusionism, where everybody went everywhere. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to remind people that the Smithsonian, from its very beginning, had the official party line that was pretty much established by Powell. And he would not allow any conflicting evidence, although I do quote in there, there's one quote of his that basically says, I can't account for this stuff outside of, you know, a more advanced civilization and culture having generated it. In other words, he denies everything until the very end, and then he says, but I can't account for it. Everyone is familiar with the classic scene in the Raiders of the Lost Ark, where obviously at the end, you know, after the Nazis and after the retaking of the Ark, and it's put into a crate and it's being taken down this massive, massive, huge warehouse on a forklift and just placed in some indiscriminate spot in the warehouse out of the eyes of everyone to see. The reason the giant bones, now here's the bottom, here is I would say the definitive statement. The reason the Smithsonian does not allow the truth to come out on this is because giants would indicate that the biblical narrative is accurate and would totally undermine Darwinian evolution, okay? And if you know the history of anthropology, there are times when the anthropologists believe that the Piltdown Man and some of the Peking Men and all these anthropological supposed species that existed, they had the jawbone of something and they built a whole mythological creature around it. Well, if they can believe a lie then and perpetuate that lie and then only grudgingly admit it was false, what makes us think that they're telling the truth about anything? Good example. We're now seeing NASA. There was never water on the moon. Now there's once water on the moon. Mm-hmm. There was never water on Mars, yet they're finding there was water on Mars, you know? We're seeing all these hints, and you and I have talked about it, the alien agenda. Here's what's key. In every area that you and I have investigated or will investigate, wherever there's a military base, Tom, wherever there's a Catholic presence heavy, those are mystical, and there are also electromagnetic contact points, like Sedona, good night. They consider that one of the most important vortexes or power centers between dimensions in the world. Well, that's what Timothy Alberino and the film crew were down in Peru, all over Peru, basically tracking down. And I would say this, if you go out and it's a bright blue sky, you camp out in front of a known stargate, and all of a sudden you've got an isolated weather war against you, obviously somebody or something was not happy with the presence. I won't say it's a supernatural thing, but it's certainly an unusual thing, and even the natives couldn't figure that one out.
Yeah, and you know, deities try to emulate God, so that how Israel in the Old Testament would follow God, and they would follow the cloud, right?
Correct.
God created what we could almost explain in chemistry, but he did it miraculously so that they would follow it. And the demons always try to emulate him. They always try to be like he is. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will be like the Most High. This is what they want, right? They
Absolutely.
Want to be worshipped as gods. So it'd make great sense. In fact, in True Legends, you talk about the storm gods, and so there's mythology and storyline that go around that whole concept since forever that would make you then wonder. Timothy goes down. He's with a group of people. He's in an area that's supposed to be a portal. Beautiful weather all over the place, and a storm just decides to come right over the top of them and have a hissy fit because they are there. Of course, electromagnetism. They can read that in the ground. Like you mentioned, Sedona, it's off the chart. And that, of course, can also play a role in our weather patterns. We've only got 45 seconds left in this program, so I'm just going to have to beg you if you can at least come back one more time. We thought we would do two shows, then three. I think we're going to have a fourth show, if you will.
I'll do it.
Okay. Folks, once again, wonderful being here on the set at SkyWatch TV with my good friend Steve Quayle. You would think that with all of the years of and hundreds of hours of radio that you and I have done together, that we would have been in each other's presence before. But this is actually the first time that we've sat down next to each other. And this time, I couldn't be happier to have him. And we're gonna when the Timothy Alberino, Steve Quayle, Gen 6 products become available, you'll see them here.
The supernatural realm is real, and we humans are naturally curious about it. That's why there are so many television reality shows featuring ghost hunters and alien chasers and mediums and psychics. By and large, the Christian church avoids these controversial topics, even though we have the authoritative book on the subject. That's our mission at SkyWatch TV, is to address issues of the paranormal and the supernatural from a Christian, a biblical perspective. But we depend on your support to do it. To find out how you can support SkyWatch TV prayerfully and financially, please log on to our website, skywatchtv.com. And keep watching as we keep watch at SkyWatch TV. They stirred up a hornet's nest with Petrus Romanus, the final pope is here. Turned up the heat with the book Exo Vaticana, and now they are on the third of a trilogy. Welcome to Skywatch TV, a daily video update. I'm Derek Gilbert. Our guest is Tom Horn. You and Chris Putnam, your co-author on those books, Petrus Romanus and Exo Vaticana, really stirred some controversy by suggesting that the Vatican knows a little more about, or thinks it knows a little more about what may be coming at Earth from outer space than they are letting on. Your new work, On the Path of the Immortals, still researching it right now. What direction are you going with this third of the trilogy?
Well, we just can't keep ourselves from getting into trouble. So, you know, Petrus Romanus was a groundbreaking work. It was started out, it was just going to be kind of an analysis of a 900-year-old Catholic prophecy, you know, not advocating that it was a real prophecy or not, but, you know, it was coming to an end. It was historic. We had evidence that there were those among the Catholic hierarchy, among the Curia, that put stock in it. Maybe they were electing popes or not electing them based on if they could be seen as a fulfillment of that prophecy. So that's all we were going to do, right? We got involved in that. And but one of the things that we did was we predicted a year in advance that Pope Benedict was going to step down, and he did. And in fact, we even named the month that he was going to step down. It turns out we were accurate. Well, when that happened, then all of a sudden the book went crazy. We were getting phone calls from all over the world, including from Rome. We had some of the Catholic media in Rome wanted us to fly over Rome to do shows, and we were warned not to go. I don't know if that was just, you know, conspiratorial thinking, but we didn't go. But what happened then was we would be doing shows. We did your program. We were doing shows with Steve Quayle. And when they were call-in shows, people were calling in and they were saying, yeah, but what do you make of all this stuff the Vatican's been saying recently about aliens and alien life and some of their theology, and we would baptize aliens and they are our brothers, and people were curious about that. So we decided that we were going to follow up the book Petrus Romanus. We were able to set up a tour. We actually went to Mount Graham in Arizona, went up on the top of the mountain, met with the Vatican representative, the Jesuit that was there that day, climbed all over their advanced telescope, went to the radio telescope. There's actually three telescopes on the top of Mount Graham in southeastern Arizona. And then we went to the large binocular telescope, in which sits the notorious Lucifer device, right? And so that seemed to, like, you know, instead of answering the questions we went there to gather, it raised 1,000 more questions, because all the way from people saying, what? The Vatican has an observatory on the top of a mountain in Arizona. What are they doing over there?
Exactly.
All the way from that, all the way to what is the Lucifer device and why are they using it? Which took us back to Malachi Martin. When Art Bell asked him years ago, why is the Vatican heavily invested in the study of deep space on the top of a mountain in Arizona? And he said, it's because they know what is approaching the Earth and that it will be of the utmost importance in coming years. Well, anyway, so we wrote a 600-page investigative book called Exo Vaticana that became our best-selling book. But now we're on a third book, and to answer your question, why? Because When we first went to Mount Graham, I had assumed that the reason that the Apache Indian and other indigenous tribes had filed a federal lawsuit, actually, to try to stop the Vatican and NASA from building that observatory on the top of that mountain, I had assumed it was because it was sacred ground to them, in the sense that their mothers and fathers, for, you know, hundreds of years, had lived on the mountain and died on the mountain, and therefore it's like a graveyard or something. It's holy ground to them. And we found out that that might be the case, but that was not the case. The big issue to them was that Mount Graham is one of four of the most holiest mountains to the indigenous people in the United States of America. And as far as the American Indians are concerned, one of four of the holiest mountains in the world. Well, then we wanted to know why. Why is it a holy mountain? And to put it in our modern lingo, it's because it is for them what we would call a stargate. A specific geographical location where things can move in and out of our three-dimensional reality. In fact, we could talk about their creation myth and the role that these mountains played. And that's why they didn't want the Vatican to go up there. So because we learned that after we wrote the book, Exo Vaticana, it put us right back in a position where, okay, we've got to finish this investigation. And I don't know how much time we've got, but you know, Chris has been investigating hotspots, locations. I'm actually leaving on Monday to go to the Navajo Nation, where we'll be meeting with some of the elders of the tribe there. Maybe we're just digging another giant hole with a thousand more questions, but we have actually filmed some phenomenal stuff. I mean, Chris's, his theology actually got upgraded. He never believed in things like orbs.
Right,
he thought
right.
it was all just a big joke.
Tricks of the lens.
Until they went there and specifically set up two cameras so that you wouldn't get a trick of the lens, and had an orb come down, hover over their head, watch them flit about, and then just literally dissipate, and film from two different angles.
Both cameras.
Wow. Followed by an enormous triangular ship that then came through the air very slow, very much like the Phoenix Lights type ship, which
they
also filmed. And we'll be providing that film on a future program on SkyWatch TV.
Okay. Now, the idea of portals, the only example we really see of something like this in the Bible is the account in Genesis where Jacob falls asleep and sees the ladder with the angels climbing up to heaven, climbing down again. What sort of scriptural evidence? I mean, is that it, or is there other... Are there other hints, clues, passages in the Bible that support the idea that there are places on earth that literally serve as gateways between this world and the spiritual realm?
Yeah, I mean, I think actually there are numerous examples. I gave a presentation at Strategic Perspectives not long ago where I mentioned seven or eight of these out of the Bible. And, you know, sometimes I might be uncomfortable using the term portal.
Yeah.
But if you specifically are talking about a high or sacred location, then you can see Moses going up one of the mountains, specifically Mount Sinai, where he is to meet with God. When Jesus returns, it says his feet will touch the top of the Mount of Olives, and he will descend. The extra biblical book of Enoch, which of course is still in some versions of the Bible, talks about the watchers who descended onto the top of Mount Hermon. And then from Hermon, they come down into the Valley of the Plain. And interestingly, later on, Nimrod, this big rascal who shakes his fist in the face of God, goes specifically into the plains of Shinar and builds a tower. And what does it say? They intended to build a tower whose top would reach into, and the Hebrew there is Shamayim, the dwelling place of God and or watcher level angels. And God himself says they will accomplish what they have imagined to do. And so he comes down and confuses their language. Now, in our modern lingo, people would say he went there to build a stargate, a portal, some kind of angelic technology that we can barely comprehend, but something that God said they will accomplish what they have imagined to do. They're going to pierce the veil. So in terms of the American Indians, they have a long history, and they commonly will simply refer to them as sky people, but they're not all good. We, in our language, would talk about this as angels, fallen angels. They also describe coming through those portals these owl-like men that look very much like alien grays, and their shaman call them bad medicine. They're to be avoided.
It's very interesting that you mentioned that, because there's a little type of figurine. It's a class from Mesopotamia, ancient Mesopotamia, that look very much like the character from Close Encounters. No, not Close Encounters. E.T., the Steven Spielberg movie, with the really big eyes. And these little figurines look just like that. They're called eye idols. And it sounds like, if you're talking about a creature with oversized eyes, owl people, that this may have been a global phenomenon.
Well, yeah. In fact, you know, I mentioned on Monday I'm headed for the Navajo Nation. One of the Navajo elders, he's one of 10 in their hierarchy, is a 92-year-old native, but he is a convert to Christianity. And get this, by the way, he was a code talker in World War II. So I'm really looking forward to visiting with him. But he is going to tell us their creation myth in the Navajo language, and then also in the English language, and we'll be providing that on film. We'll probably put it in the Navajo language with the subtitles below it. But in a quick nutshell, their legend says that in the time before time, a giant silvery disc came down over the top of the mountain, and in it sat a bearded man. He was the creator, and he began creating all life on earth. But soon after, another man comes through the portal, but he's not really a man. They said he's a dragon, disguising himself as a man, and he is a deceiver, and he begins deceiving all the peoples of the world. Soon after that, giants start coming through the portal, and they start sweeping across all the Arizona basin, you know.
It's the book of Genesis.
It's the book of Genesis. Well, in fact, they cry out to the great God, and he sends a flood that wipes out all the giants and sweeps their bones under the hills. Of course, then this goes into what? The Smithsonian cover up, because the, you know, the Mexican invaders and then the English, and they come here and they start going to all these sacred mounds, digging up these giants and hiding the bones. But yeah, so that's the title of this third book, because I know that today we're not doing a show on it. We're really just kind of whetting people's appetite to know what Chris Putnam and I are up to. The title of the book is On the Path of the Immortals. Chris is doing some fabulous research, some of the most cutting-edge research right now in quantum physics and theoretical physics. What's happening at CERN? CERN's own physicists are telling us what they're looking for. They're looking for parallel realities, and they want to open a doorway through which they say we may send something or something may come through. Well, that's...
What could possibly go wrong with that?
Yeah.
Well, we're looking forward to seeing the results of this. On the Path of the Immortals, this will result in a book, but also a four-part investigative series on Skywatch TV.
Yeah, actually, we've already shot a lot of the film. Experts from around the world talking about everything from aliens and UFOs, but from a biblical world view. But the film that we shot, we specifically went to see if what we were hearing from some of the Native Americans was true, but we didn't anticipate we were actually going to catch on film stuff that they tell us is coming through these portals, but we did. So there's a documentary film that's coming, but there's going to be a four-part Skywatch television special investigative report. That's another thing about Skywatch TV. We're going to do this several times per year, where we take a whole month and do a special investigative report, kind of a 2020-like approach, but from a Christian point of view.
Well, we're looking forward to seeing it. On the Path of the Immortals, Tom Horn and Chris Putnam back at work. Keep watching for it here on Skywatch TV. I'm Derek Gilbert.
Waging war in the unseen realm. Global events fulfilling biblical prophecy. Eternal life. What lies beyond mortality? From analyzing the paranormal from a biblical worldview to the discussion of cutting-edge science and technology. Conspiracy. Discovery. Special investigative reports. Unafraid to explore the challenging issues facing humanity. Welcome to another edition of Skywatch TV. Special Investigative Report.
Almost 100 years ago, three children in Fatima, Portugal, claimed to have a vision of the Virgin Mary, who gave them a prophecy of things that were to come. And the third secret was about a bishop in white who climbed a hill surrounded by carnage. What is the relevance to our world today? That's our topic in this special report, On the Path of the Immortals. I'm Derek Gilbert, Skywatch TV, along with the co-author of the best-selling books, Petrus Romanus, The Final Pope is Here, and Exo Vaticana, and the forthcoming book, On the Path of the Immortals, Tom Horn. Tom?
Great to be with you again, Derek.
We had talked about some threats made against the Pope, against Rome, by the Islamic State, and begun to discuss the relevance to the prophecies of Fatima, and also to the prophecy of the popes, which you deal with extensively in Petrus Romanus. The prophecy, and I guess we kind of use that word loosely as you know, Protestants. Mm-hmm. And we'll talk about the weight that we give extra biblical prophecy here in this program. But the message, the third secret of Fatima and the bishop in white, what was that third secret, and how seriously does Pope Francis take this?
I think he does take it. Well, of course, you left off on the last show talking about how he, you know, dedicated
his papacy and also consecrated the world to the what he calls the what Roman Catholics call the Immaculate Heart of Mary. But he did it in front of the statue of Our Lady of Fatima, which he had brought from Portugal to Rome for this ceremony on October 13th of 2013. And of course, that statue has the bullet that struck Pope John Paul II during the assassination attempt embedded in the crown of the statue.
So, well, and the relevance of that, of course, is that if people understand the part of the prophecy that was published, now Rome claims that it published the entire third secret, but there were many scholars actually of the third secret of Fatima, people that actually had the opportunity to read it. We're talking about, you know, highly placed bishops or cardinals that had access to it. That had indicated it said much more than what was promulgated in the year 2000. 1981, there's a guy that tries to assassinate John Paul II. In the year 2000, John Paul II is the one that authorizes the release of the third secret of Fatima. Now, that secret was supposed to be released a long time ago. You know, Lucia, or Lucy Santos, had been told by the angel or by Mary that it was to be kept a secret until around the 1960s, and then it was supposed to be published.
Yeah.
Her bishop...
And actually, when she was asked about that, she said that it was Mary that told her to hold the first two secrets until, was it 1940 or 41? But that it was on her own initiative. She just felt that the third secret would not be understood until sometime after 1960.
Yeah,
she's the one who made that decision.
Yeah, that was actually what she said. She said, at that time, you know, world developments will be such that the prophecy can be more clearly understood.
Right.
But her bishop read it, ordered it sealed, and actually Lucy, you know, she only died a few years ago, and she was essentially kept under house arrest. She was not allowed to talk to the public about the secret whatsoever.
Right.
The Secretary of State, Tarcisio Bertone, would go and visit her on a regular basis. There's some evidence that even threats were made that would come from her Catholic faith. In other words, you might not get out of purgatory as quick as you want to if the prayers are not being said. So
that was significant because at the time, the then Archbishop Bertone was the head of the congregation, which was responsible for enforcing or protecting official Roman Catholic doctrine.
Right.
So he was essentially the guy who made the final call on what was and what was not official Roman Catholic doctrine.
Right. And so the secret isn't released in the 60s because the powers that be determined that whatever the secret is, it's too troubling, it's too disturbing. And there were radio shows, by the way, you know, Malachi Martin, he was a highly placed Jesuit. He worked for three different popes. He was a polyglot. He translated the Dead Sea Scrolls for the Holy See. A highly educated guy. And after he was relieved of his priestly duties on request to the Pope, becomes a best-selling author, and he's writing these books out there. And some of his books are, I mean, they're very maverick. They're saying things about Rome becoming the seat of the Antichrist and about the enthronement of the Archangel Lucifer at the Vatican, you know, and all these things he's saying. And then he would be on TV and on radio. And one of the shows he was on, somebody called in one day and they asked him about the third secret of Fatima, and they said they had heard that the third secret had to do with Rome becoming apostate and becoming the seat of the Antichrist. And Malachi, and you can still listen to the audio file, he says, yes, it sounds like they have read the third secret of Fatima, which he had access to. Well, that's contradictory to what was published in the year 2000 when John Paul says we're going to release the third secret, and it describes the bishop in white. A bishop in white, he's walking through a city that is sounds like it's been bombed or it's been hit by a meteorite or something has happened because the city is just in ruins, in ruins.
Corpses everywhere.
Everywhere, people dying everywhere. He's walking along praying for the people as they're dying, and he's trying to make his way to a cross. And at that time, ISIS-like fighters run into the city and they shoot him, right? And they kill him. So in 2000, You had Cardinal Ratzinger, who went on to become Pope Benedict. He was part of the committee. Mm-hmm. Sodano, Tarcisio Bertone. Right. They're all part of the committee working under Pope John Paul II. And they say they're going to release the third secret. Well, when they release the third secret, all they give is that that description of the city and the bishop in white. And they say this was fulfilled in 1981 with the assassination attempt
right.
against John Paul.
But Our Lady guided the bullet and preserved him and stopped him at the threshold of death. And that's why they put the bullet in the statue of Our Lady of Fatima and the crown of Our Lady of Fatima.
Yeah. And so you had Catholic scholars, you had the Washington Times, you had the New York Times. They're all running articles saying, excuse me, he wasn't walking through a city half destroyed. He was riding the Pope mobile. He wasn't killed like the vision says that he was. And there were no other dead people. Nobody else was shot.
Right.
So it didn't match even the part of the vision that they released. Now, but is that vision something that the current Pope believes could be fulfilled by the Islamic nation? See, that's what I think. That's why I think that you hear Francis right now saying, I am willing to be assassinated if that is God's will. I just hope it doesn't hurt, because I think he's a believer. Furthermore, I think he's a believer in the prophecy of the popes, which also that final line describes how that during this Pope's time on the throne of Peter, the city of Rome is destroyed. And presumably him along with it, right? So it seems to match the Fatima prophecy. Mm-hmm. I think he's a believer in that prophecy. I think he thinks at this time he's playing his role as the final pope. Here's the thing to keep in mind about Pope Francis is he carries himself as a very humble man. And he might be a humble man, but he's not an ignorant man. He's a Jesuit. Mm-hmm. He's got advanced degrees in science, in history. He's fully aware that he is the final line in a 900-year-old Catholic prophecy that has meant a lot to a lot of cardinals down through time. Popes have even gone out of their way at times to show that they were the fulfillment of their line in the prophecy of the popes. Even documentaries made to show that I'm the one that was in the prophecy of the popes. So they do pay a lot of attention to it. And as a Jesuit, he's following a mystical path, a prophetic path, and so I think he believes in it.
Mm. Now, the Jesuit order has come under some criticism. Malachy Martin, who was a Jesuit, was maybe one of the few, maybe the only, as far as I know, ex-Jesuit, relieved of his priestly duties. The Jesuit order throughout history has been evicted from a number of countries around the world, including some countries that are officially Roman Catholic, like Spain. What is it that the Jesuits are about that the governments find so offensive? I mean, are they engaged in more than just religious education?
Well, absolutely. Of course, a lot of universities that were built by the Jesuits, the purpose was to form an anti-Reformation movement, right? When the Reformation was growing and the Catholic Church was losing lots and lots of people to what we today would call evangelical Christianity, the Jesuits were actually formed to become an arm of the Vatican to turn that curve back around, to bring people back under the fold. They were an anti-Reformation, but it included universities, intellectualisms. They would slowly, you know, if you can control the mind and the thinking and the philosophy of the world at large, then you can control everything else. Malachy Martin also said in his book, The Jesuits, that they wanted to control the Vatican in particular. Mm-hmm. And he said there was a secret war going on between the Jesuits and the other priests. And he says that if ever the Jesuits were to take control of the Vatican, well, essentially that would be the end. That's when it becomes just a machine, he says, of the New World Order, an arm of the Antichrist. And he must be rolling over in his grave today, or he must be rolling over in purgatory, to know that the very first Jesuit pope in history just took the throne. So obviously the Jesuits won that war.
And just coincidentally, after the first pope in 600 years resigned.
Right.
Generally, the popes don't resign. They're essentially carried out of the Vatican.
Which is, by the way, it's interesting because this whole special investigative report, this is going to go on for we don't know how many shows, right? Mm-hmm. We're going to have Chris Putnam here in the next program. He'll do a couple of shows with us. We'll have our field investigators here, and we'll start showing video and film from the field investigations that will ultimately lead up to us talking about what in the world is this book on the path of the immortals all about, right?
Well, we'll show you a little glimpse of that. We'll also talk about the Pope's geopolitical initiatives. He, as Tom mentioned, will be Pope Francis, that is, will be addressing the United States Congress. He's also released a very interesting encyclical that, again, has nothing to do with religion. We'll talk about that as our special investigative report on the Path of the Immortals continues next on Skywatch TV.
Now we're on our way to the petroglyphs. There are some strange images that are there.
Yeah. I saw it with the naked eye. Yeah. Did you see it?
The orb. I saw an orb with the naked eye.
What is that?
In 2012, they shocked the world when they predicted Pope Benedict's resignation 1 year in advance. In 2013, they uncovered the mysteries of Mount Graham, the Lucifer device, and the Vatican's secret plan for the arrival of an alien savior. For the last 24 months, Tom Horn and Chris Putnam have been working behind the scenes on their most guarded project and greatest discovery yet. Mount Graham in Arizona is said to be a portal, and the Jesuits admit they are monitoring something there that is approaching the Earth. But as the Vatican knows and the authors just uncovered, this mountain is not the only gateway to another dimension. Now, in their new book, On the Path of the Immortals, Tom Horn and Chris Putnam set out with cameras and field investigators to document the most astonishing evidence of those behind the veil. Armed with inside intelligence from the native peoples, they unearth chilling evidence of what the Bible says about sacred locations and the giant beings that await their time from within.
They claimed that they could actually conjure light ships down, UFOs, aliens.
So what would have caused these ancient Pueblo Anastasi Indians to have departed this area with such great haste?
We don't know why they never finished completion of the Sun Temple.
Many of them escaped right through some of these mountains, some of these old Anasazi ruins.
Travel with internationally acclaimed investigative authors of Petrus Romanus and Exo Vaticana to learn the truth behind a secret so fantastic that it took 2 years and thousands of miles of research to document what has been kept hidden from the public by elitists and intellectuals who are planning mankind's assimilation under a coming savior.
Here's the six-toed giant our Indian guide told us about. And there's the fallen reptilian with the halo above his head that came through the portal.
One whom the prophet Daniel foresaw as an alien god. On the Path of the Immortals.
Pope Francis addressing the United States Congress and issuing an encyclical that deals with how we live our everyday lives. What is this all about? Welcome back to our special investigative report on the Path of the Immortals on Skywatch TV. I'm Derek Gilbert, along with Tom Horn, co-author of the forthcoming book, On the Path of the Immortals. Pope Francis, addressing climate change. What does that have to do with religion, what, our Christian faith, our relationship with Jesus Christ?
Well, not much, I would say, frankly, from my worldview. I think that we as Christians obviously would say that we have a responsibility to be good stewards,
sure,
of creation, everything that belongs to God. But the encyclical, and we haven't seen the encyclical yet. It may be out by the time this show broadcasts. It's supposed to be any day now. Originally, I think they said it'd be during March. But there are some concerns, not just among evangelicals, but also among some conservative Catholics. One is the point we already made, that it kind of joins the church to political issues,
right,
which is a concern because, you know, this could smack of the Antichrist system. The you know, in the book of Revelation, when it describes the rise of the Antichrist, you have a political figure, mm-hmm, but then you also have this second beast that it talks about with two horns like a lamb, which scholars think that infers that he pretends to be a representative of Jesus Christ, right? The, mm-hmm, Lamb of God. But it says he speaks as a dragon, so his the voice behind the voice, his power is Luciferian in nature. And of course, ultimately, in the same parts of the book of Revelation, it doesn't take long for that to be betrayed when he starts causing all who won't worship the image of the beast to be killed.
Right. But when you marry church and state, then a disagreement over theology becomes treason.
Right. With Chris Putnam and I writing The Prophecy of the Popes, which predicted the resignation of Pope Benedict 1 year in advance, even to the month. We could get into that if we need to, or maybe wait till Chris is here. But that caused the world essentially to look at that book and to start asking some of these questions. Then we wound up in Exo Vaticana. In Exo Vaticana, we mentioned something that might be connected to this encyclical. And it takes a moment to understand this. When you start talking about environmentalism, you wonder what in the world could that possibly have to do with Exo Vaticana, which is talking about life on other planets.
Right.
But along this path we've taken, we've wound up with some conservative Catholics, including a couple of priests that are willing to converse with us via email. And one of them said, watch to see if there's anything in the encyclical that connects to this idea of many worlds. And among the Catholic scholars, there are a lot of them. Benedict was one of them that believed that there could be something to this idea of many worlds, mm-hmm. that we're one world of many. God has many more out there where our space brothers are. But among this coalition of worlds is a responsibility to nature, is a responsibility to creation. A good way for people to understand this idea is, remember the old classic film, The Day the Earth Stood Still?
Ah, yes, Klaatu, Barada Nikto.
Yes. Scared the majeebies out of me when I was a kid, right?
What had Gary Stearman started on his career path.
Right. Well, so but now in that original one, the classic, which is still the best one that was ever made, the issue was nuclear armament. We were building nuclear arms, and so, you know, the big space alien with his robot comes down here to warn us that if ever we think we're going to extend that military presence or, you know, bombs or whatever into space, we're going to become a burned out cinder, I think he says. Right. They're going to wipe us out. But that film was remade a couple of years ago starring Keanu Reeves, and it was a very subtle change, right? He comes down, he's got the giant robot, but now the whole issue is environmentalism. Mm-hmm. And this is very much taken from some of the Catholic thought about many worlds, that the angels are watching, our space brothers are watching, God is watching, and we have a responsibility to the environment. And that's a very close step to saying we are the disease. That's essentially what the spaceman in the remake of that film says. Mm-hmm. We are the disease. And this goes, of course, into Gaiaism. Will what the Pope says in his encyclical, will it hint at this idea that the Earth is a living, sentient organism?
Well, that's really interesting, because the previous Pope, Pope Benedict, in a homily in 2009, praised the work of the Jesuit Father Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, who is called by some the father of the New Age movement, but also called by some the father of the Internet, because it was he who first coined, a couple of terms that we're very familiar with. One is transhuman, and the other is social network. And he believed that he believed in evolution, and he tried to reconcile that with his faith by postulating that creation is evolving, and that as it evolves and our social networks become more complex as humans, as the world around us, the biosphere, becomes more complex, that it becomes sentient, and that at some point we will all wake up, become one with the universe at the omega point. So, and Pope Benedict actually said that the role of the priesthood was to consecrate the earth into a living host, which in Roman Catholic catechism, the host is literally the body of Jesus Christ, miraculously transformed from a wafer into his body during the Mass. So there is some thought there that perhaps this influential Jesuit thinker, Teilhard, is influencing current Roman Catholic thought, and that our role on the planet is to, again, shepherd the planet to our next stage of evolution. There may be some connection there to this idea that we are to join this, the space brotherhood, and becoming one with the cosmic Christ, the omega point, as Teilhard put it.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. In fact, Benedict actually wrote in his own book about Chardin and praised his thinking, which tells you that at least that pope, and it's, you know, it's possible that this current pope, being a Jesuit, and that was what I was told to watch for. Now, since we don't have the benefit of the encyclical yet,
but that is something to watch for in 2015.
It's to watch for in 2015 that, and actually, here's what I was told was that, and this is not something mysterious. Oh, Tom's referring to a mysterious informant or something like that. It's just to be watched for, that if something that might smack of astrobiology is not included in this encyclical, look for something later this year. In fact, that can be sourced to the current leader of the VORG, the Vatican Observatory Research Group. Jose Gabriel Funes gave an interview with the Catholic media recently. Pretty soon, he said he's going to turn his attention to astrobiology. Well, when Funes says that, he would know because they're friends, and they both have an interest. Bergoglio earned degrees in chemistry and had ambitions of actually entering into science fields before he became a Jesuit. So whether it's the encyclical is going to hint at it or later this year, but it's going to take us to the second book, Exo Vaticana, and some of the shows that we'll do when Chris Putnam gets here, because it sounds like they might be preparing us for this coalition of worlds, this mini worlds idea, in that maybe they think they know something. And they've been saying a lot of things over the last few years that lead you to believe that they think they know something about disclosure. And of course, again, that goes back to Malachi, you know, 97, when Art Bell says,
right, something coming in possibly the next 10 years.
Right.
Yeah. Or at the very least, they're hedging their bets because it is believed by many that Christians would find their faith rocked if suddenly E.T. were to land on the White House lawn,
right.
Which isn't necessarily the case, but that's for another program. So we'll deal with those in the forthcoming programs with Chris, the links between the scientific research, the astronomical research, and perhaps these ideas that the ties to how that would affect their positions of faith. But there was something else I wanted to touch on real quick with just a couple of minutes. Last fall, the former president of Israel, Shimon Peres, traveled to Rome and proposed to Pope Francis the idea of a United Nations of Religions, with Francis perhaps developing the idea, shepherding the idea to fruition. We're looking perhaps a global unity of the major religions. What is your thoughts on that? Have your research turned up anything on
well,
that?
Well, Francis has actually talked about it. So, you know, he's coming to the United States. He's going to speak before a joint session of the U.S. Congress. He's going to speak before the United Nations. But then when he goes back to Rome, he's already announced, I don't know if the date is set yet, but he's announced that he's going to call all of the leaders of the world's major religions together to talk about how we can work together in better cooperation and unity. So once again, this takes you back to this second beast that rises up with two horns like a lamb, but who speaks as a dragon, and this idea that there's going to be a final global religion. It might be kind of loose, but mandatory. The an encyclical, for instance, is kind of a mandatory piece of diction that comes down from the Pope. He gives his encyclical, which he's going to do any day now. It goes to all of the bishops, and then the bishops have the responsibility of passing forward that information to all 1.2 billion Catholics in the world, and it becomes a moral responsibility for them to follow whatever the encyclical is. Well, so this Pope's on a mission. And what might the next encyclical be? What might the next authoritative statement be? He's already telling us that following these things, he's going to get all of the nations, all of the leaders of the religions of the world together. I don't know if that's other than Christian. It might just be all the denominations of Christendom, and talk about how we can form, you know, global unity. Yeah. One very quick thing. I know we're going to run out of time, but people have heard me talk before, too, about the Zohar 700 years ago. Now, this is the most important book of Jewish Kabbalah ever. The Orthodox Jews pay attention to it. And in the Vieira section and in the subsection, the sign heralding Mashiach, or the coming of the Messiah, it said that in the year 5773, which would have been 212 to 213, the new moon of 212 or over, I think, into September of 2013, says that the Messiah would begin making himself known to the Orthodox leaders in Israel, right? Mm-hmm. And then slowly from then forward start making himself known to the nations of the world. Well, if that prophecy is true, then the Messiah, whoever that person is pretending to be or is, made himself known. So now all of a sudden they're dedicating the altar for the third Jewish temple. And I even wonder, you know, this new television series, Dig, which is implying that there's movement now about among the Orthodox priests and others, that what, are they going to announce they found, you know, the Ark of the Covenant?
And the Temple Institute is already putting out articles about the significance of the red heifer and so forth.
Right.
So we are seeing a culmination. We talked about the Muslim prophecies, especially the apocalyptic Mahdi, Mahdist versions of their prophecies. We're seeing Jewish prophecy, perhaps, coming together, and movement on the part of Rome that indicates that they see something coming that may signal the end times.
Well, and this Zohar, the point that I was going to make is it too sees the destruction of Rome at about that same time. So there is a whole concatenation of prophecies here coming together from the Jews to the Catholics to biblical to Islamic. All of them seem to be coming together at one time.
Yeah. And it's a lot to get your head around, but if you'd like to do it, now is the time, because we're offering, as part of our special report on the Path of the Immortals, a special package that include the first two books in what has become a three-volume set, Petrus Romanus, The Final Pope Is Here, Exo Vaticana, Chris Putnam and Tom Horn's first two books, their forthcoming book, On the Path of the Immortals, which will be released very shortly. All those three books together, combined with an excellent primer on the Space Brother meme, if you will, What Lies Beyond, the author Jeffrey Mardis. Those four books, plus two DVDs, special investigative report on the Path of the Immortals, and Tom Horn's presentation at Chuck Missler's Strategic Perspectives Conference on the Secret Vatican and Alien Antichrist Connection. All of that together, a $120 value for just $39.95. Tom, this will continue. We barely scratched the surface. For Skywatch TV, I'm Derek Gilbert.
Welcome to Skywatch TV. I'm Gary Stearman, and right alongside me, author, publisher, Tom Horn. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Gary. Great to be with you to announce Skywatch TV, the newest enterprise that, of course, will also have Gary Stearman as its anchor.
And I'm very delighted to be here because there are going to be, quite frankly, some things happening on Skywatch TV that are exciting, and not only exciting, but timely and much needed. Let's talk about the purpose of Skywatch TV. What do you envision this ministry doing?
Yeah, Gary, we couldn't be more excited. You know, we started out some years ago, a decade ago, with Raiders News Update, and anybody that knows anything about me knows about that enterprise. The purpose of it was really to talk about what nobody else would talk about, or maybe sometimes what they were too afraid to talk about.
Yes.
We kind of go where no man has gone before. But, you know, we started recognizing a few years ago that we'd gone about as far as we could go with just Raiders News Update and Defender Publishing, which is the publishing side of our company. And also noticing that people more and more today use video. You know, they have handheld devices, they have iPads, have smartphones, and people have busy schedules. And so we just came to believe that the time was now, if we were going to take the next step and really where we should, you know, go where we should be, that we would also introduce television. So we'll be webcasting, but we'll also be on cable television, and we'll be making those announcements pretty soon too.
Now, you see yourself as filling a kind of a gap that's out there right now for Christians. And Christians go to church, they study the Bible, they really want to understand Bible prophecy. But the churches seem to be missing the mark these days, Tom. And you and I have talked about this in the past. Let's go into that a little bit. Skywatch TV is going to fill a kind of a gap that's out there today.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, I pastored for 20-some years. And, of course, so I noticed that from the church side, that ours was one of the few churches out there, like the church you pastor in Oklahoma, that actually is brave enough to talk about the subject of prophecy. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, as time has gone on in American history, churches have pretty much abandoned the question of prophecy. And yet, when you look around the world, it looks today more than ever like we are surrounded with the unfolding of biblical prophecy. And people have questions about it.
They do.
So we feel that's our calling. We're to be one of those people that kind of stand in the gap and try to bring reason and understanding and solid theological interpretation to the news events of the day that very much make it look like we're moving into the end times.
Well, I really agree with you on that point. In fact, in my mind, it's difficult to separate Bible prophecy from the gospel. When you teach the gospel, you're teaching prophecy. When you teach prophecy, you're teaching the gospel, particularly in this day and age, because we feel that we're entering a closing era, the era mentioned by the ancient prophets. And Skywatch TV is going to move right in and begin to deal with those subjects. You know, in the movies today, we see transhumanism, we see alien invasions, and we see all kinds of things that Bible scholars, who are prophetically inclined, interpret as the subjects mentioned in the Bible. In fact, we believe that current developments are explained in Scripture, and I know you believe that.
We do, and again, that's the main reason why when we found out that you would be available, that's why we came to you and talked to you, because you're one of the few people today, Gary, that I have such highest regard for your premillennial, pre-tribulational, solid Western kind of Baptist theology, you know, that we grew up with. And it was the stuff that we preached. But today, it seems like there's very few solid theologians who remain that can keep, you know, good doctrine is really important. So if people are asking questions, and they are, what are aliens? If you watch the movies that are coming out right now, every movie is dealing with transhumanist themes, they're dealing with alien themes, they're dealing with, you know, they're also dealing now with apocalyptic themes.
Sure.
And so people have questions, and if the church isn't providing answers, then they're going to go to New Age sources or other scurrious sources to get answers to those questions. In fact, you can, if you look at the logo, Skywatch TV,
yes.
I mean, you would get that right away,
sure.
Right?
Absolutely.
Any of us old schoolers would get the fact that we're watching the sky. The return of Jesus Christ is close. But before that moment, there could be things that are happening around the world, and people need answers to those questions.
The old King James adage, look up for your redemption draweth nigh, you know, is very much a reality these days. Let's go into another subject. Let's talk about the interviewing some authors on Skywatch TV. We're going to be talking with people who are at the cutting edge of Bible prophecy, of not only the understanding of Scripture, but current events. For example, the Ebola scare is big as we're talking today. And we have Sharon Gilbert upcoming in one of our early interview programs. And she's worked on a manuscript. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. In fact, we're hoping that in about 2 weeks from right now, that Sharon Gilbert will be among those who will be the first pilot shows that Bob Ulrich, our mutual friend, will then take and use that to pitch to cable television and network television. But Sharon, we chose as one of the pilot shows because she has degrees in biology. Mm-hmm. She's qualified to talk about what the Ebola virus and other types of possible pandemic situations are. But what I love about Sharon is she's not only academically qualified and engaging and articulate, but Sharon also believes in Bible prophecy. So she believes that the day is coming where one of these contagions, whether it's some form of Ebola or the bird flu or something else, might be one of those plagues that are spoken of in Scripture. Now, I should say very quickly that I have read the first draft of her book, and the book is titled Ebola and the Fourth Horseman of the Apocalypse. It's very good. I loved it. It's engaging. Sometimes it's scary. But what I liked about it is she also includes very practical things that a person could do to protect themselves if a pandemic actually did break out, for instance, here in the United States. Well, we hope to have her right here in this studio, sitting here with you, talking about Ebola. And what people will draw from that is Skywatch TV, in different kind of ways, is going to be kind of a new paradigm in Christian broadcasting, meaning that we're going to be a little bit old school, right? Mm-hmm. We're going to deal with some of the old line stuff.
Absolutely.
And the theology and the doctrine and history and things like that. But we're also going to be in the news, taking the top stories around the world and putting them in a biblical worldview, in the context, so that people will know what that might mean for them.
And you've got a lot of plans, including an online journal. Skywatch TV is going to have a readable contribution to the public discourse. Tell us a little about that.
Yeah, well, first of all, a brand new website is coming. And so that people know this, Raiders News Update is going to become Skywatch TV. There's a brand new website. It'll be very commercial. It'll be very much driven by this kind of media content, video content. There will still also be headlines there, but people will see that cleaned up a great deal, which we've needed to do for a while. We also are going to launch a magazine in the first quarter of 2015, the Lord willing. That is our plan. And at first, it'll only be an online magazine, and it'll be free. And so we'll have some of the top prophecy thinkers in the world that'll be contributing to that magazine, and we'll make that available. And then there's one other thing before we run out of time, Gary, that I want to mention.
Okay.
And that is this other aspect of it being a new paradigm in Christian broadcasting is we're going to do something kind of like, if people are familiar with the television show 2020.
Sure.
Yeah. Kind of a news journalistic investigation kind of approach to doing television. And we even have some of our first investigations already in mind.
You know, investigative journalism has a huge history, but it's never really been brought into the biblical arena. And lately that has started to happen on a small scale, but you're going to enlarge that a bit.
Yeah, we actually are. As a matter of fact, the book for this investigation has already been written. It's this right here, Redeemed, Unredeemable. And this was an investigation by myself and Donna Howell, where we literally went behind the iron bars of America's largest prisons. And for some of the people that are still alive, for instance, we talked with the Son of Sam killer, David Berkowitz, who is now a Christian of fame and has been for quite a long time. We actually talked with the main hitman for the Manson family, Charles Tex Watson, who is now a Christian. But this is going to be followed up with by a film documentary. So when I say we're going to have this investigative journalistic kind of approach, a couple times per year, we'll kind of break in. And then now, instead of it just being Gary Stearman talking to somebody like Sharon Gilbert, there may be several people on this set where we've went to a remote location, we've filmed experts in different issues, and we're bringing back a special report, and that may play out over a period of 3 to 4 weeks.
Well, I'd like to say that I've read Redeemed, Unredeemable, and what it did for me was bring out the idea of the gospel. Knocking on doors, leaving tracts. A lot of us have gone through the idea of sharing the gospel. We've been through it, and now we're out the other side, and we've lost interest. But that gospel is as fresh as it ever was, and we need new ways of bringing it to new and different people who haven't heard it before. And I think Skywatch TV is going to be a big part of that.
Well, we're certainly excited about it. We wanted to shoot this first little video here so we could put this out online to introduce you as the anchor of Skywatch TV and give people just a little bit of information to whet their appetite about what's coming.
It's going to be great. I'm looking forward to it, and I think you should too. I'm Gary Stearman for Tom Horn, and it's going to be exciting, so keep watching us, will you?